great pleasure now to introduce Albert Rienzo, the president and CEO of Blue Highway, a subsidiary of Syracuse University. Please join us at the podium. Blue Highway is famous for a translation of scientific discoveries into working products. And Albert is an expert in creating innovation cultures, renowned lecturer on health technology, and member of many distinguished academic, government, and industry boards. In his spare time, the secret is that Albert enjoys designing custom motorcycles, and he started his innovation career, I may take liberty to disclose, by taking apart a beautiful Italian pendulum clock which belonged to his family. Well, you have to go to Italy to get a new one. It will be a special assignment to visit Leonardo da Vinci's town. That's my own observation is that Albert has a rare combination of social sensitivity, intellectual depth, and incredible communication skills that makes him a true leader. I would like to officially congratulate you on becoming a professor of forensic science. Could you share with us the history behind it and connection to the future of health? And maybe we can use the other mic and the other podium.
Thank you, Renata, for the very kind introduction. So as far as becoming a professor of forensic science, I think a lot of it was actually motivated from the work I did as part of the 13-member National Biodefense Science Board for appointed under Secretary Leavitt under the Bush administration, where we were tasked with protecting the American public, setting policy for chemical, biological, radiological, and nuclear threats, whether from natural or man-made disasters. And so from that, I was the one person on the board that was responsible for diagnostics. How do we rapidly detect, predict where an event might occur, prevent, and then involve with some of the medical countermeasures. And I think a lot of that has an impact on healthcare, because back to what Dr. Teague was talking about and you earlier, it's a big data problem. A lot of it's a big data problem, and how do you prevent, how do you predict? I think some of those things are finding their ways into new e-health types of approaches. I think there's also some pretty interesting things that are going on in sort of novel countermeasures and vaccine productions and just a number of new antimicrobials, a number of things that are coming out of that biodefense work and BARDA that finds its way into the healthcare system.
Well, I was also wondering if you could tell us more about some most innovative medical devices that you delivered to Welch Allyn Medical Device Giant. What would be your pick of three most innovative devices? I know you produced maybe 12 of them recently.
Yeah, that's a really tough question. If I had to pick three, some of them are in the translation stage right now. One would be a non-invasive Alzheimer's biomarker. It's a visual field test. It takes about 6 minutes to run. We, myself and two of our scientists, were just at the National Institute of Aging talking with them about that, and we're going into a larger clinical study. But it has about, I would say it's more of a screener versus a diagnostic. It's about 89% to 90% sensitive and specific. But it can tell you if you're clear, like in the a control group, you have cognitive complaint, mild cognitive impairment, or Alzheimer's. And it's sort of a game changer again. And this could be a frontline care. I mean, it's tens of dollars for the test. And it's, again, non-invasive. So it's in the process of trying to get larger studies. We've had 120 patients, and we're moving it out to a bigger platform. Another one, which probably doesn't sound so exciting, but to a Welch Allyn, it would be, since they're a leader in thermometry, is a core temperature thermometry, which gets the temperature of at the base of your brainstem. It's uses the energy that your body gives off, so it's totally non-invasive. It gets the information in about 4 seconds. And it, initially, it's contact pretty much anywhere on the body, but it is moving towards non-contact, and it could probably be used for heart rate and respiration rate, again, in a non-contact manner. So it's a very small device where they used to be about the size of a tabletop, so it could be almost like the Star Trek tricorder type of thing. And then I would say another one is optical coherence tomography applied to an otoscope. So the traditional otoscope, to look in the ear, but now it has interferometer or spectrometer and all that within the same body. So the clinician can still see what's going on in the ear, but now it applies an A scan, a horizontal scan, to the, and it can tell what's going on the backside of the tympanic membrane. So it can say, do you have a bacterial infection, a viral infection, is the bacteria a biofilm? And biofilms is typically what creates the reoccurring ear infection. So again, for a Welch Allyn that's a leader in otoscopes, that's a huge game changer.
So you shared with us some new innovations. Now, to get back to the bigger picture, what do you perceive as three biggest challenges of healthcare today? Yeah. What is your...
Again, that's a tough one, and that's such a target-rich environment, you might say. I think one of them is just human behavior, which feeds so many other things, right? I mean, there's a lot of issues around that, so you could argue, is that really a healthcare problem? Is it not a healthcare problem? But compliance is an issue. Human behavior is an issue. You could hold off probably 90-95% of the chronic diseases and different infectious diseases and so forth if you adopt different behaviors. The second one I would say is obesity is a huge problem. Everybody hears about it. It's in the news. You know, talk about what's going on in the U.S., and the U.S. is not actually the worst country as far as that goes. Middle East, believe it or not, has a lot bigger problem, and it leads to all sorts of, type 2 diabetes, all sorts of structural bone structure issues and other healthcare issues. So I would say that's a problem. And then infectious disease, we do focus a lot on chronic diseases, but I think there's also needs to be a focus on what's going on with infectious disease and different things that are sort of making their way now into the healthcare system and within people's lives. So I'd say, I'd pick those three.
So what three technologies you think will help conquering those challenges?
Yeah, one, both of you had already talked about was big data. And I think the better that we understand and the better that we can move towards better analysis, prediction, interoperability, prevention, and so forth. So the whole, virology, proteomics, genomics, all the omics that Dr. Teague was talking about is interesting. The thing I liked about your one slide in particular, Dr. Teague, was if we can drive towards that personalized healthcare, but if you can take all the vital signs and all that other big data, and you can register that data, that disparate data, fuse that disparate data, and you can have new learnings from it, I think that would be huge. So I think big data is certainly an interesting one. E-health, and I use that as the superset. You can talk M-health, telehealth, telemedicine, HIT, right, all those things, but I sort of say e-health is the superset, and it has to do with the interoperability, connectivity, true ubiquitous types of interaction and communication across disparate systems. It would be nice also if there's some emerging new antimicrobials that can be manipulated and activated in a number of ways. And so a lot of these antimicrobials are non-leaching, completely cytotoxic, completely regenerative, have very fast-acting, very short response times based on the manipulation, which may be through light, it may be through a current, electrical current. And if I could throw a fourth one in there, I mean, it's sort of back to just common sense. If there's something that we can do that help people, so again, can that e-health remind you to eat your broccoli, as you were saying, versus having your mom tell you, eat your broccoli. So there are things we could do to help. But a lot of it's just common sense, that could really have a major impact on the healthcare system.
So now, how are you pulling together the knowledge of technologies that can help those challenges with the know-how, how to build innovative teams to tackle those problems and produce products? So what is your secret behind leading innovative teams like Blue Highway to produce tools usable to consumers or hospitals or healthcare ecosystem?
Yeah, there's probably not a secret. Everybody in the team is very smart, very capable. I think part of it is I've worked for big companies like Philips and Siemens Medical Systems as well as a few startups. And part of it is just creating that culture of innovation and giving the people within the company a lot of freedom to incubate, a lot of freedom to operate, really creating an environment that's productive. So if you look at Blue Highway, it's a very small company, and we leverage a lot of graduate students, master's and PhD students around the clock. We actually have hundreds of collaborators that we work with from the outside. So there's a lot of smart people out there, right? And it's not like any one company has the knowledge. So we try to pull together the academics, the industry people, the clinicians, the government folks, and come up with potential solutions that can be long-lasting. And we typically don't take on incremental innovations. We focus on things that are orders of magnitude beyond what is there today or meeting unmet needs. So if it's just sort of like the next great increment or the next great widget, we don't particularly care about that. So we're looking for the radical or breakthrough types of innovations.
Yeah, in the spirit of celebrating 10th anniversary of Future of Health Technology book, where I describe Doctor of the Future, which is this intelligent caring creature or intelligent caring machine that can tell you everything whenever you need it. Are you looking forward, it's a personal question, are you looking forward to actually being on the receiving end of something like that?
Absolutely. I mean, I'm a real fan of personalized healthcare. A lot of times people talk personalized medicine. A lot of times that's more sort of gene therapy or focused on cancer types of things. But I like the idea of pushing healthcare to the subacute care settings, pushing it more into the home, everyday life. I mean, really about prediction, prevention, early intervention. Reducing risk and safety issues. Helping in compliance. So I'm a real big fan of personalized healthcare. Matter of fact, years ago I wrote what was a foundational document adopted by HHS as forming that basis for personalized healthcare. So I'm very passionate about that. And I think a lot more has to come on the individual. I mean, we can't expect government. Matter of fact, one of the things from biodefense, we say you're your best first responder. If you're waiting for the government or an EMT or a policeman or a soldier or somebody to take care of you, forget it, because you're typically going to be waiting 24 to 48 hours in a disaster scenario. So you're your best own first responder. And I think people need to take accountability for their own health.
Thank you, Albert. Thanks for sharing your thoughts with us.
And thank you.
We'll move on with the program.